Unto the six Goswamis, namely Srila Rupa Goswami, Srila Sanatan Goswami, Srila Jiva Goswami, Sri Gopal Bhattat Goswami, Sri Gopal Das Goswami, Sri Raghunath Das Goswami, who are all very expert in scrutinizingly studying all the revealed scriptures with the aim of establishing eternal religious principles for the benefit of all human beings. Thus they are honored all over the three worlds, and they are worth taking shelter of, because they are absorbed in the mood of the gopis and are engaged in the transcendental loving service of Radha and Krishna. Okay, so we're going to go ahead this evening. First of all, a little review of what we spoke about yesterday. We explained the meaning of Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, the name Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, that it is there's an ocean of the nectar of devotion. And from the teachings of Lord Chaitanya, we're going to know something of a small portion of that ocean, a few drops. But from the nature of a few drops of the ocean, we can understand the nature of the ocean. So, but we should understand there's a whole unlimited ocean of bhakti ras. And then we discussed about the significance of Srila Rupa Goswami. We explained how someone may be a follower of Lord Chaitanya, but they may not be following Srila Rupa Goswami. But it was Srila Rupa Goswami who was given confidential instruction from Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And Just as Lord Brahma's heart was enlightened with the Vedic knowledge by the mercy of Lord Krishna, in the same way, Srila Rupa Goswami was empowered to write books on the science of devotional service by the mercy of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So if we want to understand Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, it's very important that we should follow the teachings of Srila Rupa Goswami. The followers of Rupa Goswami are called Rupanugas. So we are, you can see also in the pranam mantra of some of the very great spiritual masters, they're described to be Rupanuga. One of their qualities is Rupanuga, that they expert in following the teachings of Srila Rupa Goswami. So we are also following his teachings by hearing from him in this book, Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. And then we described also, identify Prabhupada's purpose in writing the Nectar of Devotion and discussing their relevance. That Srila Prabhupada wants us all to be familiar with the science of devotional service in the different rasas, in the different mellows of devotion. By hearing this message of Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, as described in Nectar of Devotion, then we can understand properly how to apply ourselves in the teachings of devotional service. And it's the relevance of this is beneficial not only for us, but for people all over the world, whoever they may be. Because the teaching, the principle of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is that anyone from any walk of life can become a devotee and can be elevated to the Krishna conscious platform. We were explaining yesterday how Srila Rupa Goswami and Sanatana Goswami had become degraded. They had become Mohammedans, and they had even taken on Mohammedan names. Dabir Khas and Sakara Malik were their names. But Lord Chaitanya made them Goswamis. And so anyone who follows this teaching of Nectar of Devotion, they can also become elevated to the level of Goswami, by simply following this message of Lord Chaitanya. Of course, Lord Chaitanya also elevated Haridas Thakur to the position of Namacharya. And Haridas Thakur, he was born in the Mohammedan family. So birth is not important. It can be an advantage. If you're born in a nice Brahminical family, it's certainly an advantage, but it is not the absolute criterion to becoming Krishna conscious. Okay, so then we also explained the objective of Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, that it's to establish the position of Lord Krishna, Vrindavan Krishna, Akila Rasamrita Murti. The form of Lord Krishna is the supreme form of the Lord, and that supreme form is manifest in Vrindavan. So Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu elaborates on this fact that Lord Krishna's pastimes in Vrindavan are the supreme pastime. It's in Vrindavan that Krishna displays all of the different rasas, and he's having all the highest rasa, the highest exchange of loving rasa with his devotees there in Vrindavan. And then we presented an overview of the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, and specifically the Purva Vibhag. We explained the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu like an ocean, and there were four sections of the ocean: the north, the south, the east, and the west. So the Purva Vibhag was the eastern section. It was the beginning. The first 19 chapters are described to be part of that Purva Vibhag. And within that section, the first section, there are four waves. We explained yesterday there are four different waves within this first section. And the four waves are, first of all, there's a description, an overall description of the principles of devotional service. And then Rupa Goswami goes in to explain, first of all, sadhana bhakti, which means devotional service in practice. And then he explains about bhava bhakti, or devotional service in ecstasy. And finally, he explains devotional service in love of God, prema bhakti. So these four different ways are all described in the Purva Vibhag, which we are going to be covering gradually. It's the first section of the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. So going ahead to lesson two, we're going to speak about the definition of pure devotional service. Right? This Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu is about pure devotional service. Right? There are different levels of devotional service, but we are particularly interested in pure devotion. And we will be looking this evening. We hope by the end of this evening you will be able to identify what is actually pure devotional service and what is mixed devotional service. Just like someone may be a pujari, someone may be offering worship to the deity, it does not mean that they're performing pure devotional service. We have to look at the attitude, we have to look at the manner in which the service is performed. We have to look at the motivation behind performing the service. These things, Prabhupada explains in the Nectar of Instruction, in the preface to the Nectar of Instruction, that everything depends on the attitude of the devotee. It's not just the service itself, but it's the attitude in which we perform it. So we're going to be explaining tonight about how different attitudes are there in the performance of devotional service. So here is the verse which is given to us by Rupa Goswami, this definition of pure devotion. I will chant, you can repeat. Anya bilasita sunyam,
anya bilasita sunyam,
jnana karma jnana vritam, Anuko yena Krishna no,
Anuko yena Krishna no,
Shilanam bhaktir uttamam,
Shilanam bhaktir uttamam.
Okay, so this way Srila Rupa Goswami has defined what is pure devotion. When first class devotional service develops, one must be devoid of all material desires, knowledge obtained by monistic philosophy, and fruitive action. The devotee must constantly serve Krishna favorably, as Krishna desires. All right, so very important verse, which we should all try to remember. So, within this definition, we should understand there are two different levels of criterion. One is what we call Swarupa Lakshana. Swarupa Lakshana meaning the essential characteristics which must be there at all times. And the other is the Tatastha Lakshana, which are described as being marginal characteristics. Sometimes it will be there, sometimes not. Right? So these two kinds of characteristics, two classifications are there. Some qualities in pure devotion are Swarupa Lakshana and some are Tatastha Lakshana. We will go on and explain which ones are which. Here you can see Swarupa Lakshana is described first of all. Anukuyena Krishna and Anushilanam, right? Anukuyena Krishna Anushilanam, right? That was the second half of the verse. And from the first part of the verse, we have the Tatastha Lakshana, Itatasta qualities. Anya bilasita sunyam jnana karmatya navritam. So you can see the first section of the verse, the first half, first portion, are the marginal characteristics, and the second portion are the essential characteristics. We'll explain to you the meaning of these different terms. Swarupa Lakshana. Anukulyena, meaning favorable, devotional service should be favorable to Krishna, right? Favorable to Krishna meaning it is pleasing to Krishna. So we know there are certain demons who are also doing, they're also remembering Krishna, they're thinking of Krishna, but their thinking is not favorable. Just like Kamsa was always thinking of Krishna, but he was always thinking Krishna's going to come and kill me, and he was thinking how he could kill Krishna. He wanted to come and kill Krishna before Krishna killed him. So Kamsa is an example of someone who was always remembering Krishna, but not in a favorable manner. And there are other demons also like that, like Sishupala. Sishupala is famous for being envious of Krishna. Remember Sishupala, he wanted to marry Rukmini. But then just before the wedding was going to take place, Krishna came, took her away. Then what a blow to his ego. And Sishupala had always been envious of Krishna, because Sishupala was very opulent. Just like, you know, maybe you have someone you compete with, you know, maybe you have a sister you compete with, or a brother or something, or some friend. You're almost the same, but they're always a little better. They always beat you. You know, you feel, oh, I really, one day I'm going to beat them. Why do they always beat me, you know? They beat you maybe one mark or two marks, or, you know, they're always a little better than you. So you feel envious to them. So Krishna was like that. Krishna was always more than Sishupala. Sishupala was so powerful, he's a great king, he's very opulent. But Krishna had a little more, a little bit more. And then it came out at the Rajasuya sacrifice. They were doing the Rajasuya Yajna, and they were glorifying Krishna. And so Sishupala could not tolerate it anymore. And he got so angry, he began to blaspheme everyone. So then at that time, then Krishna took his Sudarshan Chakra and finished and liberated him. So Sishupala is another example. He was always thinking of Krishna, but not pleasing, not in a pleasing way. So service must be done in a manner which is pleasing to Krishna. And it must also be in such a manner, it must be performed with the intention to please Krishna. So first, it should be pleasing to Krishna, and we should have also the intention to please Krishna. A little difference is there. One is, we may do something, we may think, I'll do this, but it's not pleasing to Krishna. We may have the intention of pleasing Krishna, but it may not be what Krishna wants. Someone may want to offer their beer to Krishna. They may be thinking, you know, Krishna, let Krishna have a bottle of beer. Yeah. But it's not pleasing to Krishna. If you offer meat, fish and eggs to Krishna, it's not pleasing to Krishna. You may want to please Krishna. You may be trying to please Krishna. Your intention is there to please Krishna, but it's not pleasing to Krishna. It's not what Krishna wants. So, anukulyena means service must be favorable to Krishna. It must be both pleasing to Krishna and we should have the intention to please Krishna. Now, there are special cases, for example, Putana. Putana came and she's offering her breast milk to Krishna. She wants to, you could say, please Krishna. And Krishna, of course, liberated her. Though Krishna, but Putana got, she was very fortunate, although she's coming to kill Krishna, but because she was offering something to Krishna, because she was offering her breast to Krishna, so her, in some ways, intention was there to please Krishna. And Krishna liberated. Another person, Pundraka. Pundraka also got liberation. He also got to go to the spiritual world. But Pundraka was, you know, he was dressed up like Vishnu. He had put on two extra arms. And he was dressed in yellow robes, just like Krishna. He was telling Krishna, give me that Sudarshan Chakra. You should give me these symbols. They are from, I'm Vishnu, not you. So Krishna gave him Sudarshan Chakra, right across the throat. He cut his head off. Yeah. And even those were special cases, Pundraka and Putana. But generally, devotional service should be in such a way that it is both pleasing to Krishna and the intention should be there to please Krishna. And then we talk about the word Krishna. And the verses, Anukoyena Krishna no Shilata. So we should understand Krishna, Krishna to mean Krishna and his personal expansions. So Krishna includes all such expansions, as well as his pure devotees, Prabhupada writes. Sometimes we wonder, well, I don't know Krishna, I'm just doing service for the pure, for my spiritual master, or I just want to serve Srila Prabhupada. Is that enough? That's perfect. That is serving Krishna. If you're serving Srila Prabhupada, if you have that mood of serving Srila Prabhupada, then that's acceptable. That is pure devotion. Yeah. So Krishna, you, somebody else wants to serve Balarama, someone wants to serve Lord Nrsingadev, someone serving Tulsi Maharani, that's also pure devotional service. So we don't separate some Krishna's paraphernalia from Krishna. There's no difference between Krishna and his paraphernalia. Just like the holy land of Vrindavan, the holy Dham, Mayapur, Vrindavan, Mathura, these places are not different from Lord Krishna. If you do service for the Dham, that's not different from doing service for Lord Krishna. Just like we're serving, we chant the holy name. The holy name of the Lord is not different from the Lord himself. So by serving the name, we get the benefit of serving the Lord also. We say chanting the holy name is both the means to perfection and perfection itself. It is both the means and the end to achieving the goal of life. So this is another Swarupa Lakshana, that don't separate Krishna from his paraphernalia. Prabhupada was always concerned about Krishna's paraphernalia also. The arti paraphernalia, it had to be cleaned, polished, very important. And the prasadam, the foodstuffs which are offered to Krishna, it had to be very well prepared. I was reading, Srila Prabhupada went to one temple in South America and he said, bring me the maha, I want to see what they're offering to the deity. And after Prabhupada tasted it, he said, this is terrible. He said, this is terrible. We said, why they don't know how to cook? He was not satisfied at all. Another time in Los Angeles, they brought Prabhupada some sweets which they'd prepared, and it was all some chocolate thing which they'd made. And Prabhupada said, "What is this?" He said, "I taught you to make Bengali sweets. Where do you got all of this thing, all of this chocolate from?" He said, "Why don't you make Bengali sweets for Krishna? Nice milk sweets instead of all of this concoction." Another time I remember in England, we had the Radha Landanishwara on the lower level, and above them, above their heads, were Jagannath, Baladev, and Subhadra. So we had very nice flower arrangements around Radha Landanishwara, but somehow we'd not put any flowers around Jagannath, Baladev, and Subhadra. And Prabhupada immediately noticed, "Why all the flowers here? Why nothing is there? Jagannath, Baladev, Subhadra don't have any flowers. Why is this?" Prabhupada was very concerned about these things. Even the incense is Krishna's paraphernalia. And the madanga, we don't put, Prabhupada didn't like to see madanga on the floor. How you can put the madangas on the floor? It's Krishna's paraphernalia, sacred. We would make stands to keep the madanga drums. Just like we don't put our books, Krishna's books, on the floor, the madanga is also Krishna's paraphernalia. We cannot just simply place it on the floor. And these are all devotional items. You see, we have to understand these things. Don't separate Krishna from his paraphernalia. Just like some people say, "Oh, Kurukshetra is not important." But actually, Kurukshetra is important because Lord Krishna has his pastimes there. Actually, Prabhupada said about Kurukshetra, he said, Kurukshetra is famous for Krishna speaking the Bhagavad Gita and also for Rati Atra. So he said both of these things are very important in our Krishna consciousness movement. We are preaching the Bhagavad Gita and we are also performing Rati Atra. Both of these things took place at Kurukshetra. So it's not that the place of battle is important, but because they're in connection with Krishna, they're important. Everything in relation to Krishna is important. The holy place of Kurukshetra is important because it's connected with Lord Krishna. In the same way, the madanga is important because we use it to chant the holy names of the Lord. The flowers are also Krishna's paraphernalia. Flowers shouldn't be on the floor, you see? Flower petals are on the floor. We don't let flowers on the floor because it's Krishna's paraphernalia. So these are things we need to remember. Going ahead, the next point. Anushilanam. Anu meaning following or constantly. And shilanam meaning, what does it mean?
Behavior.
Or can also, anushilanam, sometimes it Prabhupada describes as meaning cultivating or activities. The Krishna consciousness means activities. Being Krishna conscious is not just doing nothing. We don't just sit and meditate, but we're active in the service of Krishna. There are activities to be done in the service of Krishna. And Srila Prabhupada explains, activities can be classified. There is pavriti and nivriti. Pavriti means things we should do, and nivriti means things we should not do. Later on, if you look in the Nectar of Devotion, you will see different items of devotional service are described. and there are mentioned there certain things which we should do. What should we do? We should come before the deity, come and see the deity, offer obeisances to the deity, offer prayers to the deity. Then some temples, we will circumambulate the deity, accept the charanamrita from the deities. These kind of things. This is what we have to do. Do this. And certain things we should not do. What should we not do? We should not come in front of the deities in the, wearing our shoes, for example. We take our shoes off before we come in the temple. We should not speak mundane things in front of the deities. We should not argue in front of the deities. These kind of certain things which we should do, things which we should not do. So, different kinds of activity. And we have to be guided in these activities by the help of a spiritual master. Therefore, in performing activities, it's very important that we have the proper guidance from the higher spiritual teachers. The spiritual master should be there to guide us, to tell us what you do, what you don't do. If there's nobody guiding us, we don't know. Well, I don't know. Nobody told me. Well, we have to be guided. We have to have some spiritual teachers here to tell us constantly, to check on us. That is why Srila Prabhupada said he was always traveling to save us and to guide us and to correct us. So in the same way, so many other, in Srila Prabhupada's absence, so many other senior devotees, sannyasis, and different Vaishnavas are coming to guide us and to help us to progress in Krishna consciousness. So activities are important in our Krishna consciousness movement. The Krishna consciousness movement is not meant for just lazy people. In fact, Srila Prabhupada often said the Krishna consciousness centers are not for lazy or crazy people. In Prabhupada's time, unfortunately, we did see these kind of people come to the Krishna consciousness movement. Some were lazy and some were crazy. But anyway, activities have to be performed. Activities are done with the body, with the mind, and with the words, right? We use our mind for the service of Krishna. Maharaj Ambarish is a great example of a wonderful devotee. And it's mentioned the very first thing which he did was to fix his mind on the lotus feet of Krishna. Savaimana Krishna Padaravindayo. He fixed his mind on the lotus feet of Krishna. We're meant to think of Krishna within our mind. That's the first thing we have to do. In order to perform our activities in good consciousness, there has to be some consciousness of Krishna. Of course, before we become conscious of Krishna, we first have to be conscious. If we're not conscious, then it will be very hard to be Krishna conscious. So first we become conscious. Prabhupada has the Krishna consciousness movement to make all of us, first of all, conscious that we're not the body, right? In our ignorance, we're thinking, I am the body. That's our madness. We're all crazy people before coming to Krishna consciousness, because we were all thinking we're the body. But we come and we learn we're not the body. And then we learn about Krishna. So, being conscious of Krishna, we have to hear about Krishna. We hear about Krishna, for example, at Kurukshetra, speaking Bhagavad Gita, and being the charioteer of Arjuna, And some other people, they like to think of Krishna and Vrindavan with the gopis, with Radharani performing Rasa Lila or Chulan Yatra, some different pastimes are there. Some thought of Krishna has to be there. We use our mind to think of Krishna. It's very important for us to hear about Krishna. Therefore, in the very beginning of our movement, Prabhupada gave us the Krishna book, which is actually the 10th canto Srimad Bhagavatam. But he gave us the 10th canto Srimad Bhagavatam in such a manner that even though we are neophyte, we can be greatly benefited by hearing about Krishna's pastimes. So by hearing, then we can think of Krishna. So we use our mind to think of Krishna and we use our body to engage in his service. Particularly, we do kirtan. Kirtan is one of the very best ways in which we can serve Krishna. Chanting the holy name, kirtan. So that kirtan, that of course that is the Yuga Dharma. Lord Chaitanya came to engage all of us in this kirtan. Param Vijayate Shri Krishna Sankirtan. Not just any kirtan, but Krishna Sankirtan, right? Glorifying Lord Krishna. Okay, so we're explaining about these different Swarupa Lakshana, essential characteristics, right? We said Anya Vilasita Sinyam Jnana Karma Janavrita. Anukuyena meaning favorable, and then Krishna meaning service to Krishna or any of Krishna's paraphernalia, which pure devotees. And now Anushilana meaning the cultivation of activities. Here we have a quotation here, something from the introduction. Prabhupada writes, the particular word used by Srila Rupa Goswami in this connection is anushilana, or cultivation by following the predecessor acharyas. As soon as we say cultivation, we must refer to activity. Without activity, consciousness alone cannot help us. So one may say, I'm thinking of Krishna. I'm thinking of Krishna. What are you doing for Krishna? Prabhupada, when Prabhupada would come to visit our temples, he would want to know, how many books have you distributed? How many new devotees have you made? How many properties have you acquired? My goodness, you'd have a hard time in Singapore. Huh? You came to Singapore and asked these questions. You'd be very disappointed. We still have a way to go to satisfy Srila Prabhupada. Anyway, these things were very important to Srila Prabhupada. And of course, he also was very much concerned in how we take care of the property. He would examine everything. When he would come to Mayapur particularly, he would go and look at the toilets and see if they're clean. These things are very important. Prabhupada would check on everything. So I was very glad to see the toilets are kept much cleaner now than when I was here before. So at least we've upgraded the toilets. There are still other things to be done. I notice they're still using styrofoam plates downstairs. Although I've mentioned on several occasions before that this is not right, that we shouldn't be using styrofoam, but still, we're still using it. Now, I was told before it's the Bengalis. Well, if it's the Bengalis, then you have to train, you have to talk to them, you have to train them. But you know, our movement does not support the use of styrofoam. We want to be eco-friendly. Now, especially in Singapore, you know, which is a very modern place, and they do care a lot about ecosystems here. And so they do, you know, they make great efforts to avoid pollution and to avoid littering and keeping the air clean and having good water to drink. I've heard, you know, Singapore, you can drink the tap water here. But it's very bad to use styrofoam. These things are not very good. So you want to please Prabhupada. These, all of these little things are important. Srila Prabhupada is, you brought Prabhupada here. No, you have to make him happy. You have to please him. You have to satisfy him. It's not just putting his deity here and offering Guru Puja, but activities, the proper activities. I often give the example that if the husband comes home from work and he sees his wife sitting there not doing anything, and the home is all dirty, and the children are running around, and they never got fed, and they never did their homework. And the husband says to his wife, "What are you doing?" She said, "I'm just thinking how much I love you." Then the husband is not very thrilled, right? In the same way, we may say, "I'm thinking of Krishna, I'm thinking of Prabhupada." But Prabhupada wants to know, what are we doing? He wants to see the activity. Right? Very important. So Krishna consciousness means activities for the pleasure of Krishna. He would ask devotees, "What service do you do? What do you do?" So this is a sign of our consciousness. Not that, "Oh, I'm always thinking of Krishna Prabhupada." No, he wanted us to do so. If we're thinking of Krishna, then we will want to serve Krishna. We will want to go out and preach. We will distribute books. We will be engaged in many different activities for the pleasure of Krishna. Okay, here's another quotation here. From Back to Godhead. The word anu suggests that one should engage himself in the service of the Lord without any interval. He must be engaged in the service 100%, always. There must not be any interruption in such progress of devotional service. So analysis, more further explanation of the meaning of this anushilanam, meaning constant engagement. We often speak, you know, they have these convenience stores everywhere, 7-Elevens and like that, you know, 24/7, right? They're open every day, they're open all night. And so devotional service is like that, or meant to be. Pure devotional service without stop, without gaps, no deviations, constant, no days off, no holidays. Oh, no holidays, not fair. People won't be eager for that job, right? But of course, taking rest is also part of our service to Krishna. We have to take rest in order to do service for Krishna the next day. So it's not that you cannot sleep. Again, you can also take rest, you have to do things. You have to have some recreation sometimes in order to keep yourself working effectively. So it's important to balance the program, balance our life in such a way that we can always be fully engaged in Krishna's service. But this is the idea that even you do take a holiday, you take your beat bag with you, right? You don't leave your beats at home. You take your beads with you, and you continue chanting, and you take one of Prabhupada's books, and you can read also. It's not that you can't have, you can't go away for a while. Yeah, you can have a holiday, in a sense. But there's no holiday from devotional service. So that's the point. Okay, so here's the analysis of the whole thing. Anukoyena, Krishna should be pleased from it, and the devotee's attitude towards Krishna should be favorable. So that's the first thing. And then, second thing, Krishna and the various expansions, Balaram, Prajumna, Sankarshan, Aniruddha, Vasudev, Krishna's paraphernalia, Krishna's pure devotees, they're all considered part of Krishna, not different from Krishna. Service to them is not different to service to Krishna. And anushilana, constant activity, following the predecessor acharyas, right? Mahajana yena gata sapanta, we should follow in the footsteps of the great devotees. What did the great devotees teach us? They taught us to chant Hare Krishna. They taught us to study Srimad Bhagavatam. They taught us to worship the deities. We're just following whatever we're doing because it's taught to us by the previous acharyas. We're not doing anything different from them. So these are all in the category of Swarupa Lakshana. These are all essential characteristics of pure devotional service. Now, here are some Tatastha Lakshana, the marginal characteristics, which may sometimes be present and may not. First of all, Anya Vilasita Sunya. Anya meaning other. And Abhilas, desires. What does this mean, Dylan? Motive. Okay, so what is our motive? Sunya. Sunya meaning zero, nothing. We spoke about sunyavadis, right? Nirvishesha sunyavadi. So sunya, zero. The Buddhist idea is to make everything zero. So anya bilasita sunya, right? So anya, that all these desires, all these motives, they should be zero. We want to get rid of them. Now, one may be in a life-threatening situation. Maybe your life is in danger. Can we pray to Krishna to save us if we're in a very dangerous situation? Is it wrong to pray to Krishna to protect us? What do you say? Is that in the category of pure devotion? Don't be shy. Huh? Is it wrong? Have you ever been in a very dangerous situation? You prayed to Krishna? Huh? Yeah. Do you do it every day? If you do it every day, then that's not pure devotion. But if there's some special, very dangerous situation, you're in a really tight situation, very dangerous, you're very worried, okay, you can pray to Krishna to help you, to save you. That's not against the principles of pure devotion. That is allowed. You're in a very dangerous situation. But we don't do it every day. If you do it every day, then it's not really a very dangerous situation. Then that's not considered pure devotion. But in a very difficult situation, unusual situation, you're in a very tight, very difficult, very demanding situation. So we can pray to Krishna. Oh, Krishna, help me. Krishna, save me. It's okay. That's pure devotion. But if you do it all the time, then it's not pure devotion. That's the point. So devotee, devoid of all material desires. That's the idea. Prabhupada was saying you have to be devoid of all material desires. The devotees were going, devotees thought, we have no hope, how will we ever? Then Prabhupada said, at least you must be 90% free of material desires. And devotees are not. So Prabhupada, but 80% at least you could be devout. So then Prabhupada, anyway, just hold on to my dhoti and I will drag you back to God. So Prabhupada explained like that, even though we still have material desires, But if we hold on to Srila Prabhupada, then he can drag us back to Godhead. Anyway, this is tathasta lakshana. It may be present. We may be devoid of all material desires. We may still have some material desire, as I explained, a very life-threatening situation. Janma karma janavritam. Janma meaning what does it mean? Impersonal philosophy. Jnana or jnana karma janavritam. Jnana, impersonal philosophy. If one is an impersonalist, a mental speculator, then that is not favorable to Krishna. By knowledge, by jnana, do you make progress quickly? Do we make progress very quickly by jnana? Huh? No, right. What does Krishna say in the Bhagavad Gita? Bahonam jnanmanamanti jnanabhamam prapajan. After many births and deaths, we come to the platform of knowledge. So by knowledge, it takes a long time. Right? It's not quick. But there are some rare souls. They come to the perfect stage by jnana. But generally, we want to be devoid of speculative knowledge. The jnana which is talked about here, impersonalism, speculative philosophy, this is not allowed. This is not in the line of pure devotion. We can speculate on the scriptures, but not just simply on the basis of our own judgment, our own mind. Our speculations should be according to scripture, guided by scripture. That is a lot. But impersonalism, if we come to the conclusion of impersonalism, then this is against the principles of pure devotion. And karma, adi, meaning material, fruitive activity, we should also, we don't want to maintain a lot of material desires in the practice of devotional service, right? We want to be conscious of these material desires, that they're a big barrier to Krishna consciousness if we're attached to so many material things. Rather, we should be attached to Krishna. So, all of these different kinds of service, they have to be given up. Things like mystic yoga, getting yoga powers, or being artificially renounced, all of these things are not encouraged. They don't help us to progress in Krishna consciousness. We want to guard against them. Cultivating knowledge will simply make our heart hard. And if we have a lot of sense gratification and material opulence, we become very attached to it. I was reading a quote today, Prabhupada was saying, he said, better you don't buy your house, just rent a house. If you buy a house, you get attached to it. If you just rent the house and you think, well, it's not my house. But as soon as you buy the house, then you become very attached to it. Okay, so anavritam, not covered. We should uncover these desires, get rid of them. Okay? So anavritam. Uncovered mental speculation. Go ahead with the rest of it.
Pure devotional service is given by Rupa Goswami, Anya Minashita Shunyam. No desire for fruitive activities of philosophical speculation or yogi, mystic yogic magic, no simply how to satisfy Krishna. That is bhakti. Anukulena means what is favorable, what Krishna desires. That is first class bhakti.
Okay. So the highest bhakti is described like that. These different characteristics are there. We want to understand what is the highest. Now, what we're going to do? Do you have that? We have some examples. We're going to look at these, and we want you to consider this pure devotion or not. Okay, here we are. Okay. Here's the first question. A devotee purchases green coconut and what is it?
Brings the temple for all the lords of Shiva.
Yeah? A devotee purchases green coconut and brings them to the temple, all for the lords of Abhishek. So is that considered pure devotion? Read the following and discuss. In relation to Swarupa and Tatastha Lakshana. Now, is a devotee purchases coconuts and brings them to the temple for the Lord's Abhishek. Is that considered pure devotion or not?
Yes.
Everybody agree?
Yes.
Yeah. He's not just an ordinary. Now, if an ordinary person, somebody who's not a devotee, if he purchases coconuts and brings them to the temple, is that considered pure devotion? Huh? No. It's not. But he's an ordinary person. He doesn't do it all the time. He's not serving Krishna all the time. Remember, the criterion was that we should serve Krishna all the time, right? Continually. So someone's not a devotee, they come and they're offering some service to Krishna. It's good. Of course, it's very good. But we couldn't say this is pure devotion. There's a difference. But someone else is a devotee and they bring that, then that is continuation of their pure devotion. What about number two? A full-time temple pujari accepts financial maintenance from the temple for his grihastha maintenance. Is that considered pure devotion? What do you say? Some should say yes. Anybody? Anybody agree? Anybody disagree? Have we got any full-time devotees here who do worship the puja, doing the puja? Not in Singapore. Right? In Malaysia, we have many. So, what do you think? Let's look at the criteria. What is the criterion? Krishna, are they serving Krishna?
Yes.
Are they fully engaged, constantly serving?
Yes.
Yeah? And is it favorable to Krishna? Is it pleasing to Krishna?
Yes.
We hope so. We hope so, right? What about the tatastha part, the jnana karma janavritam? What about that? Are they serving Krishna with some speculative idea? No. What about some fruit of... Well, they're getting maintenance, right? They're getting maintenance. Of course, they need maintenance, right? Somebody is serving Krishna, you know, if he's a householder. Now, if he's a brahmachari, he doesn't need maintenance. Brahmacharis don't need maintenance. Brahmachari will be maintained in the temple. But if somebody is a grihastha, they're living near to the temple, or living outside the temple, or maybe living in the temple, but he may have a wife and family, he may have some material obligations. So he may be given some maintenance. Now, maintenance means minimum. Means he's not going to become rich. He's not going to make a lot of money. He's getting minimum maintenance, enough to just maintain himself. That's all. So that is in the category of pure devotion. Number three, a devotee daily cooks offerings of bhoga for the deity in the temple, and he often burns preparations. Is that pure devotional service?
No.
Why not? Yeah, Krishna doesn't like the burnt sabjis, right? Krishna doesn't appreciate burnt sabjis, so it's not pure devotion. Number four, a grihastha devotee regularly bathes the feet of Vaishnavas visiting his home. Is that pure devotion?
Yes.
We have to consider his attitude. What's his motivation? Why is he bathing their feet every time? What's he trying? Is he doing it simply for the pleasure of Krishna or simply to honor the devotees? Everything depends on the attitude. We hope it is pure devotion. Okay. Number five, a devotee makes life members because he can keep 10% of the collection for his own use. Pure devotion?
No.
No. Okay. Number six, a grihastha devotee works in an office to maintain his family who are all Vaishnavas. Pure devotion?
Yes.
Okay. What if they're not all Vaishnavas? Pure devotion? It's a problem, right? Yeah. Means they're going to be buying meat, fish and eggs, and smoking, and drink, maybe doing other things. Not very good. Number seven, a grihastha devotee performs garbhadan samskar in order to beget Krishna conscious children. Pure devotion?
Yes.
Yes, pure devotion. Number eight, a devotee keeps a picture of Goddess Kali on his altar because she can bestow wealth on her worshippers. No? Number 9, a Sankirtan devotee regularly cleans his vehicle at the car wash because he considers the vehicle Krishna's property.
Yes.
Pure devotion, okay. Number 10, a guest visits the temple and gives a donation for the Seva Puja of the deity. Pure devotion? No, right, it's not. We have a quote here, I'll read it to you. It's a statement from Giriraj Swami in relation to Anushilanam. He said, if he's not continuously engaged in the cultivation of devotional service, it cannot be called Uttama Bhakti. It's not pure devotion. Someone might come into the temple and the deity might inspire him. And he might put some money in the box just to please the deity. And he might sing some bhajan just to please the deity. And then he goes out and does everything else. Meaning, that's all nonsense. So that's not pure devotion. It has to be systematically cultivated. Okay? Number 11. A devotee keeps a picture of Nrisingadeva on his altar because he can remove obstacles in devotional service. Right, beautiful. Number 12, a brahmachari attends Mangal Aarti every day because he wants to maintain his position on the temple council. Pure devotion? Mixed devotion, right? Number 13, a devotee performs fasting every Ekadasi because he may receive the boon of getting a son. Pure devotion? Not really. A devotee collects donations, regularly performs festivals for the Lord in his temple at home. A devotee collects donations and regularly performs festivals for the Lord in his temple at home. What do you think? What do you say? Is it all right? Is it pure devotion?
Depends. It depends on the devotee whether he likes to do separately.
Everyone can come to his home? Is his home open to everyone? Certainly controversial. But if there's no temple in the area and he's having a program, inviting, and then everyone's allowed to come, could be pure devotion. Let's analyze it. Is it pleasing to Krishna? Is it, he's certainly worshipping Krishna, and his intention is to please Krishna, and is it continuous? Maybe, every festival he does it, continuous service. And then karma, jana karma jana, the question is karma, is there some fruitive mentality there? Well, if he uses all of the donations for organizing the festival, and all the money goes for prasadam and distribution, then pure devotion. Not a problem. If all the money he's collecting in donations, if it's all being utilized 100% in the service of Krishna for distribution prasadam, then I think it could be considered pure devotion. But as you say, that the attitude is very important. You know, sometimes people do food for life. some places, you know, they collect money for food for life, but they don't spend all the money on food for life. So much goes on it. Other things, other expenses, administration costs and things. So these are problems which come up. Number 15, a devotee regularly performs what? Yogasana, to keep himself fit for preaching Krishna consciousness. Is that pure devotion? In Bharijan Prabhu's book, Surrender Unto Me, he writes that Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur said that you can go for a walk and chant japa. You can go for good japa walks and chant at the same time. And so the acharyas, they encouraged going for a walk. Yoga asanas, it's a question of how much time and how long. You know, is it something you do all the time, every day, yoga asana, how much time you're taking out? And some minimum kind of exercise just to keep healthy. Just like being a devotee, sometimes you don't get a lot of time to go around, to move around, to keep healthy. So you have to do some exercise, just as it says here, just to keep fit for Krishna consciousness. So you can dovetail it in the service of Krishna. You may say it's mixed devotion. It depends on the person. An ISKCON guru travels to the Middle East for preaching because Indian people there can donate more money than people in India. Is that pure devotion?
No.
Why not? He's using all the money for Krishna.
Yes. His thoughts is only on money, not on...
Well, he's using the money for Krishna, right? If he's doing service for Krishna. So, if you just preach to poor people all the time, then you won't be able to do much, you won't build a nice temple for Krishna. You'll never have any money for book distribution. Nobody's got any money to purchase books. A little difficult. Prabhupada built the temple in Juhu. How did he get the money to build the temple in Juhu? The devotees went to Japan. They went to Japan and distributed books in Japan. And Prabhupada encouraged them because they were giving all the money to him. So time and circumstances, you have to consider those things. If there was a real need for the money, then you're okay, you had to go to the Middle East, you get more money there, you can use it for Krishna. But if there was no need for the money, just like now in India, they have a lot of money. You know, you don't need to go to the Middle East to get money. India has a lot of money now, so much money there in India. Why go to the Middle East? There are so many temples, so many devotees there, so much more preaching there in India. So not much need to go to the Middle East. Anyway, we want you to understand how to look at the picture, to see things according to Shastra, that there are these two qualities, the Tatasta and the Tatasta Lakshana, and the, what's the other one? Swarupa Lakshana, Swarupa, the essential characteristic and the temporary characteristic. So, in this case, the ISKCON guru traveling to the Middle East, it's for Krishna. He's going preaching. That's certainly pleasing to Krishna. And of course, there's some fruitive motive there. Not without material desire, but that material desire is in relation to the service to Krishna. So if it's just simply going there to get money for no purpose, then there's no point. But if you have a good reason to utilize the funds, like they're building TOBP, okay, give all the money to Mayapur, build the TOBP, then all right. Okay, so in this way you can understand something. I think that's the last. Oh, some more. A new devotee wants to take initiation from a pure Vaishnava guru who has many disciples in the zone. He has many disciples in the zone because he will get better facility after initiation. So obviously, fruit of mentality, right. The gopis worship goddess Katyayani because they wanted to have Krishna as their husband. Is that pure devotion?
Yes.
Gopis are pure devotees, right? So yeah. They can worship, you can worship the demigods to get Krishna as your husband. Okay, so in this way we are telling you, look at the overall picture, see the different characteristics in devotional service. Any questions?
So regarding this pure devotional service idea, assessing the situation based on this verse.
Yes. Well, Rupa Goswami has given us this verse. It's for all devotees, whether they're ISKCON or not. We should understand ISKCON isn't the only institution. We don't have a monopoly on pure devotional service. We are simply following Srila Prabhupada, who gave us teachings of Rupa Goswami. But there are other institutions who also practice Bhakti Yoga. And some may even also be following Rupa Goswami. So they can also be practicing pure devotional service. We don't think we're the only pure devotees. Don't think just because they're not in ISKCON, they cannot be pure devotees. No, they can also be pure devotees. In the disciple course, that question also comes up. That we also understand that pure devotees can also be in other societies outside of this one. And we respect them. So they're following the principles, they're following the same thing, the same standard is there. There was no ISKCON in the time of Rupa Goswami. Right? Rupa Goswami didn't write that statement just for ISKCON. It's for all followers of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Any other question? Okay, then we will stop. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Thank you.